I've not sent invitations out to everybody because this is more of a conversation between me, G-Man, and Tommy, and one or two others. So I don't want it to be flooded with lots of people. But it's good to be here with everybody, and it's good to be live. I'm sure lots of people will come later on in the next few days to watch this video and to see the conversation. So for those who do come, it's good to be with you. This is Tommy, and hopefully we're going to be having G-Man in the next 5 minutes. Tommy, good to see you, bro.
Yeah, good to see you, Jason. Love you, brother.
You too, mate. We were talking about John Piper's book, Desiring God, and how his thesis in that book, and you can go and listen to about 6 videos called The Round Table, where students at his seminary talk about the book. And basically the thesis about the book is that our fullness of joy, our treasure of joy, should be in God. That should be the foundation. So what do you think of that, Tommy?
Yeah, absolutely. To me, the way I look at it or understand it is that you glorify God by fleeing from yourself, and that you, hello, G-Man, and that you cling to Him, and that you honor Him, and that you love Him, and that you uphold the commandments. And so, I mean, I think that's what we were ultimately designed for. That's how we were created. And that's why, you know, there's something special about the Christian, I think, you know, that a lot of people can see. And there's just an inner sort of peace and a calm, because it is the only way to truly be at peace and contented, and nothing else other than the name of Jesus. And I'm speaking on my own experience. And I was a seeker in life for a lot of things. You know, I tried to put my faith in a lot of things. I didn't know I was doing it at the time, but you know, whether it be I kind of dabbled in sort of health and diet and cures and this just kind of the alternative sort of life. And so I really got into that. I really got into several different things, you know, whether just sort of outside activities, and none of it really ever brings you any peace. And so that's the only thing that I believe brings real peace. And I believe that's what we were created to glorify God. And so I think, anyway, that kind of, I sort of makes a circle, I guess, maybe, but I think by fleeing from ourselves,
amen,
that is what, you know, when we're weak, then He's strong, and we put our faith in Him, then, you know, that ultimately, I think when you let go of yourself and you put all your trust and faith in Him, that actually increases your desire for Him.
Amen. G-Man, Tommy, thanks, bro. I just didn't want to show I was being ignorant to G-Man. G-Man, it's good to see you, bro.
It's good to see you guys, too. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, hey, G-Man.
Yeah, we were just talking, G-Man, about John Piper's book, Desiring God, and Tommy was just sharing about the thesis. Piper was just saying that our foundation of joy, our treasure of joy, should be in God, and Tommy was just expounding on that. When you came in, that's why I let him speak and talk, because at the end of the day, it's all about God, and so it was good stuff. Thanks, Tommy.
Yeah, sure. Sure thing.
I'm not showing my face because I've been in bed all day. I've had a flu, and if I start coughing, you'll see my hair sticking up, and you'll see me in my pajamas. that's why you can't see me. I'm not hiding.
Oh yeah, no problem.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, G-Man, it's good to be with you. The title of tonight is A Conversation with G-Man, and we discussed a topic beforehand, and if you want to go on that topic, you're welcome to do. The thing is, I think that whatever conversation we have tonight, number one, that we're all brothers in Christ, we love each other. Number two, whatever we're doing, We just want to bring people to God. So I hope that whatever we share tonight, that in the end we can focus on God and get people to focus on God. So over to you, G-Man. Is there anything that you want to share tonight, bro, or say anything about whatever?
I realize that some Christians are being approached by the atheist community regarding what I said on Talking Stuff Tuesdays. And I'm saying stuff because I don't believe in cussing. When that does happen is usually when I'm enraged or when I'm not on YouTube, you know. Yeah. Tommy, are you okay, Tommy?
Yeah, I'm good.
And that show was dedicated pretty much to me, at least from what I saw. They spent the better part of that time calling me dumb and giving all these other reasons why I was dumb. And I watched the program, you know. But like I said, there's only but so much insults a person can take, I guess you could say. So, you know, he entitles his program Talking Stuff Tuesdays. Okay, fine. So I go in there, and I confront them on this stuff about me being dumb. Of course, my microphone's being muted. They're saying I'm over-talking people and all this other stuff and whatnot. But the reality is they're muting me and all this stuff and whatnot. So being disrespectful. So I challenge J.D. King to a debate. If I'm as dumb as the atheist community claims I am, then he shouldn't struggle, stutter, have any problems with any of the questions I have to ask whatsoever, which I know he's going to, because he knows I'm not dumb. He knows that, like, within himself, you know? Then the whole part about Fiona and Alex Botton came up. Now, this would bring some of you who are watching this up to speed. I had a Skype conversation with Alex Botton, and, you know, he was going back and forth with the, you know, with the arguments or whatever, and I had asked him a question. I made a statement, and then I asked a question about does he have anything going on with Fiona? And from that time on Skype till, you know, I guess today, I have yet to hear him say no. I've heard him say I shouldn't have to answer such a question or give me one of those kind of answers. But he didn't give me a definitive yes or no. And I'm a yes or no type of guy. You know what I mean? You can give an explanation after your yes or your no, but the point is you got to give an answer. He never gave it to me, so I'm free to believe what I want to believe regarding it if he can't give me a straight answer. So, and I even mentioned to him in a Google Hangout on my channel that you're an atheist, you don't have the same restrictions I have. I believe adultery is wrong, and I can tell you definitively why it's wrong. That you, as an atheist, you can't tell me definitively why it's wrong. You just give me your own personal opinion or whatever. You know, so when I went on Talking Stuff Tuesdays and they just kept attacking me and attacking me and attacking me and attacking me, I said, you know what? I'm going to troll them. I'm going to troll them hard. And that's precisely what I did to Fiona and Alex Botton in that particular show. Mark Unora is an atheist, and he saw right through what I was doing and said, oh, G-Man's trolling them. That's a smart move, G-Man. And I had several other Christians know that I went near trolling them. It wasn't nothing to be taken serious or nothing like that. It's Alex Botton's own fault for not giving me a definitive yes or no to the question that I'm asking him. Now they're saying that if I don't provide any evidence for what I'm saying, that somehow it's going to prove I'm a slanderer or a liar. And there's a couple of things I like to say about that. Number one, I don't have any evidence regarding Fiona and Alex Botton, okay? I trolled them. That's what I did. They do it to me all the time. They do it to you, Jason. They do it to Tommy. They do it to all sometimes. When Skype Jason about this, and you said the things that you were saying, I'm in agreement with you on something. I have been a little clever with what I've been doing because, you know, for the longest time, we keep hearing Fiona talk about you and Richard Rasberg, and how it affected her kids and all this other stuff and whatnot. But this woman has yet to give anybody any evidence whatsoever for any of that. Alex Botton makes claim after claim after claim here on YouTube. He doesn't give anybody any evidence for anything. He gives you, like for example, with Veckel. Veckel's pro-slavery. No. You took something that Veckel said with a what-if situation and accredited it to him as being pro-slavery. You was being dishonest, Alex. Okay? And in other situations where he's been dishonest, about some things. And from my perspective as a Christian, as he definitively the Bible doesn't exist. And he claims to be an atheist in saying this. Okay, even though that argument that he uses has been destroyed so many times, it's not even funny. So I'm still waiting for this evidence regarding Richard Rasbury, Fiona. I'm still waiting. I'm talking about real evidence. I'm talking about for something that's serious. You know, you affected a person's life here on YouTube. You affected Jason Byrne's life. I want to see this evidence. You're not going to show anybody, but I still want to see it. And by the way, if I'm on a show called Talking Stuff Tuesdays, and I'm talking stuff, that should be a light bulb to you that G-Man is just running his mouth on this show. But everyone in that Google Hangout, you know, took it like a good captured fish, you know. I'm done.
Do you want anything, Tommy?
You know, these guys, they're the masters of fake outrage and fake drama. And they are, you know, they're out trolling, fishing, and trying to, it's almost like they're trying to lure people in a way to say something that that they can run with. And it happens, you know, I have that little streak in me as well. I mean, I have that streak in me that, you know, I like to stick little daggers in people sometimes. It's just there's something that I admit, it's kind of a weakness of mine that it's kind of fun to engage in. But I guess my point is that any time that those little jabs go a little too far, possibly, or they're taken wrong, immediately they take those, like if it's in chat, and they'll copy and paste them, you know, and then several people generally share them, and then they round up their little friends, and they all sort of gang up, and so that's just, it's kind of like those guys, they are like they're kind of like a wild pack of dogs in their mentality, because when they sense weakness, then they attack. That's what the other side does, you know. Christians are the opposite. We don't, you know, when we come across somebody who's weak or somebody who's hurting or someone who makes a mistake, even we're supposed to wrap our arms around them and love them. But the other side, they attack and they exploit, and so, you know, it's one of those things. I understand, G-Man. I mean, you are. You're human, and when we get in those hangouts, it's happened to me. You know, we're surrounded generally by 8 or 9 atheists, and they're being as they are, and they're trying to bring something out of you that they can use, you know, for their own advantage. So, that's why for me personally, I don't really get in. If I see a hangout going and there's 8 or 9 atheists, I don't even bother, because nothing good can happen, you know, because very, very likely you could have tempers start flaring or whatever. And generally, if there's that many atheists, you're not going to get a word in anyway. So I guess that's all I really have to say. It's not a great environment for a Christian.
And I agree with you. And Beckel said it best. These atheists are going to think what they want to think anyway. You know what I mean? I can come on here sounding like Mother Teresa is still going to find a reason why I'm evil here on YouTube. You know what I mean? I could give away all my stuff to the poor, and they're going to find a way how that's disgusting. How can a Christian give away all of his stuff? This is how wicked they are. But this is the part that the atheist community doesn't get, and I'm going to take this opportunity, if you don't mind, to preach the gospel a little bit, if you guys don't mind. Well, at least the bad part, the bad news of it, okay? Right now, if they're watching this, they're saying, oh, G-Man just admitted he's lied. He lied. G-Man's a slanderer. Oh, G-Man, you're finished. Let me remind those of you who are atheists out there, you've been calling me. I've been on YouTube for two years and some months or whatever, two years and about 3 months. You guys have been calling me a liar for 2 years and 3 months. Nothing new. You've been calling me, well, slander is going to be kind of new because you want to take the pressure off of Alex Botton, your God, and that's all fine and well. But the point of the matter is you've been calling me that for 2 years and 3 months. This is when I capture your, this is when I say check. If anybody knows anything about chess, the object of the game to trap the king to make sure the king can't go anywhere. But this is when I say check, and checkmate comes after it when these guys start making their videos. And then they'll start realizing I'm not as dumb as they think I am. Romans chapter 3, verse 10 says this. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. That includes G-Man. Left to myself, I'm a nobody, I'm unrighteous, destined on my way to the lake of fire. But let's read on why the person is unrighteous. Okay? There is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Their throat is an open sepulchre. With their tongues they have used deceit, and the poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace they have not known. And there is no fear of God before their eyes. Now, if we were to skip ahead to verse 23, this is what it says. For all have sinned and has come short of the glory of God. What's my point in saying that? Guys, even if I never said, and this is what the atheist community does not understand, it proves they never studied the Bible, prove they don't use proper exegesis enough. At the end of the day, even if I never did what I did with the Fiona and Alice Botton thing, in my eyes, I would still be a liar. Okay? According to the scripture, we have all sinned and has fallen short of the glory of God. James 2:10 says that if you break one law, you break them all. Okay? So, you guys are going to just take this one little event that just happened and try to say, oh, G-Man's a liar? Let me help you guys out with some other stuff. The chocolate atheist and all this other stuff that I do on YouTube sometimes. As a matter of fact, the chocolate atheist wasn't even the first time I tried to pretend I was an atheist, except the only difference is in the actual video I revealed I was joking around. Okay? And it just proves that we all fall short. Ain't none of us telling the truth 24/7. That includes you, Alex Botton. Just because you try to go about, you try really hard not to lie, doesn't mean that you don't lie. Like you're trying to convince everyone here on YouTube. That's a self-righteous mentality that even atheists don't even like. Okay, so I'm not making no excuses for nothing. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. Okay? What I did and the things that you guys do on a regular basis prove that we all sinners and we all fall short of the glory of God. But let me tell you what the difference is, guys, for those of you that are watching, between myself and you guys. When you stand before, because you rejected Christ, because you rejected the Messiah, because you say you don't need atonement for your sins, because you ignored the blood of Christ, you ignored his sacrifice, you mocked him, spit upon him, ridiculed him, killed his people, tried to humiliate his people, slander his people, lie on his people, God's going to remember your sins, and he's going to throw you into the lake of fire with the devil and his angels. And read Matthew 25 and give a couple other passages of scripture. I think it's Revelation 21 where it goes into the great white throne judgment. Okay? Me, on the other hand, Tommy and Jason Burns, we have sinned before Almighty God. The difference is we have the blood of Christ on us. And if you remember, I'm sorry if I'm talking too long or whatever, but if you remember the event in Exodus called the Passover, what did God not killing all of their firstborns? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. All they had to do was put the blood on their door, and the angel of death passed by the house. And whoever didn't have the blood on that door, they was punished. Okay, they lost their firstborns, and that was all of the Egyptians. Okay? The same situation with myself, Jason Burns, and Tommy. When God's judgment comes, God's going to be looking at the blood of Christ. He's not going to be looking at my sins. He's going to hear me say, I don't believe I should be in heaven for anything that I did, but I'm trusting on the one who gave his life for me. God made him who had no sin to become sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's why I'm saying check. What the atheists are going to make a mistake and do is claim they know scripture. They're going to start making all these videos. G-Man's a liar. G-Man's a slanderer. And I'm going to say, yeah, I am. But so are you, according to Romans 3:23. Mm. We have all sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. And you need Jesus more than I do. Because I already have him, as far as I'm concerned. But they need Jesus more. Because they know the truth, and they're rejecting it on a daily basis. Think about it. How much greater is their condemnation going to be when they stand before Almighty God? when we go to Lord, yes, Lord, I confess I did this. I confess I did that. I confess I did this. And I confess I did that. These people can't even do it in front of human beings. What makes you think they're going to do it in front of God?
Well, I watched a couple of things. I watched the J.D. Cain show that he was on, the last one recently, and I was absolutely disgusted with the way they treated you. It was absolutely horrendous. It was just absolutely disgusting. That's number one. Number two, I think that people don't know this, but G-Man encouraged me a lot behind the scenes because I was being picked on by a few key atheists, and he said he'd stand up for me, and he did. In the new year, he went and stood up for me and called some of these people out, and you know, I appreciate that. So those are some things. I think the issue with Mona and Alex, I think it's a bit unwise, you know, to talk about this situation. Because, I mean, I've done it in the past. I did it with Non-Stamp Collector. I did it with Aaron Ra. I said things that were a bit too close to the bone. And I had to say sorry about it. So I think it's whether there's truth in it or not, it's best just to leave that and drop that. The other thing I just want to say is I think that, you know, the debate that you had on The Amazing Atheist, there was some guy on there, I don't know who he was, I can't remember who he was, but he was an atheist. I went to his Facebook and he regarded himself as a real atheist intellectual. The books that he was reading and all that, and he comes across as some kind of atheist intellectual. And you wipe the floor with him. You utterly destroyed the guy. And that is you at your best. But when you went on the J.D. Cain show, and there was about 10 of them there, and they were just ripping into you, taking the mick, those are places that you're better off staying away from. You know what I mean? And keep doing the things that you're best at, and not get too much involved with these people, because you know what they're like. So you know, I've said these things to you before, and I'm just saying them because I love you, mate. That's all.
Well, let me tell you the results of recent actions. What the results of recent actions are going to result in with my channel and other Christian channels on YouTube, because I noticed a lot of people are taking this attitude now. A lot of us feel like we're wasting our time talking to the atheist community. A lot of people within the atheist community, rather. And we only want to talk to the ones that are actually respectful, or have a reputation of being respectful. So I'm no longer doing hangouts on my channel with the atheist community. If I do a hangout, it's going to be with Christians, and we're going to be talking about Christian matters. And if an atheist does show up, this atheist is going to have a reputation, of being respectful towards Christians. I'm actually going to be setting up debates on my channel. Again, the same disrespectful atheist that was on Talking Stuff Tuesdays ain't going to show up in any of these debates, because I don't respect them as being intellectuals or being people who know how to have debates without acting like jerks. Yeah. And by the way, everything that happened in that hangout goes against J.D. Cain, whether he knows it or not. I don't know if you're aware of this, Jason, but Redline gave me an award called the Dumb Person of the Year Award or whatever. Right? Yeah. I think it was in response to what Rand Campbell was doing. So when they gave me this award, they're saying that I don't know anything. When they're calling me dumb, that's pretty much what they're saying. I don't know anything. I'm uneducated. I don't know anything. So J.D. Cain has agreed to have a debate with me on my channel. Okay? I told J.D. Cain on Google Plus, I told him straight up, if you stutter, can't answer one question, and if you get a least of any criticism from both the atheist or Christian side, because remember, if I'm as dumb as you guys claim I am, nobody is going to agree with me. Nobody. and I told him that atheists can't vote for the winner, only Christians can, because I figure if I'm so dumb, you know what I mean? We don't need to let the atheist community vote on the actual debate. So
Well, I
got he's going to find out really fast that trolling isn't good. He's going to find out really fast. Forget it.
Yeah, I was just going to say the tactic of lying about your opponent, and especially the lie about them not knowing anything, is very common.
Right.
And that's my experience is they use that, they pull that when they don't really have anything else. And so usually they do it to either get a rise from you, mm-hmm. or to try to convince whoever they're talking to or whoever their audience is that they're in the right and you're in the wrong. Mm. So, you know, that's to be expected, I think. You know, when they say that, that's very common. and they say it constantly. You know, they say it to me all the time, and maybe about a lot of subjects I need to learn more, but I do have my strong suits, and they still pull that anyway. So,
Tommy, let me ask you a question, Tommy. Obviously, from our perspective as Christians, lying is a sin, you know, mm-hmm. and according to the scriptures, punishable by death, like the fire, separation from God, right? So we know why lying is wrong from our perspective, right? And there's other reasons, too, besides that. It hurts other people, right? Mm-hmm. But from the atheist perspective, why is lying wrong?
Well, I've asked the same, not with lying, but it even goes even further, because what they're going to say is that it hurts somebody else. You know, if you lie to somebody, you know, it ultimately may hurt them. And that's true with other things, rape and murder. They'll say, well, that hurts other people, so that makes it wrong. Well, I've never gotten an answer as to why is hurting somebody wrong, especially if a greater good is done, or a supposed greater good, you know. And sure enough, you know, that community will cloak really bad actions and behaviors under the guise of, well, it's good for society. You know, and so they Hitler did that. You know, he honestly thought he was doing the world a favor by ridding the world of the Jews, and so that's a very common tactic too. But I've never gotten an answer as to what exactly is wrong with hurting somebody. I've never heard an answer with that regarding that. I don't think there is one. No, that was all I was going to say.
Okay, and the reason why I'm asking is I know they're going to make videos saying that G-Man's a liar, G-Man's a liar. It's like they don't, I'm going to admit this live on air. They don't know it, but they're being strung along, and they don't even know it. Dog barking. Give me one second, guys. Hold on.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, so they're being strung along, and let me explain to you what I mean by that. My experience with the atheist community here on YouTube is that they, and just like you said earlier, Tommy, I think in a different way, though, they say things and they do things to get a reaction out of us, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when I say and I do certain things, I've learned that the atheists are kind of predictable. When you do back them up into a place where they can't do anything, you can put them in a position where they have to be objective and not subjective with their views. The majority of the people that's going to call me a liar is going to argue that morality is subjective until it fits their purposes to try to say that I'm wrong no matter what, regardless of their opinion. You understand what I'm saying? And then that's when I'm going to make my next statement on YouTube, and they're going to look stupid and inconsistent again. And it's their own fault, because they continually do stuff like this. They're being intellectually dishonest with their positions. Oh, it's subjective. It's just according to this person's opinion or that person's opinion or that own person's subjective worldview. And then I'll do something like I did with the Fiona and Alex thing. Now all of a sudden it's absolutely wrong when they don't believe in absolutes. That's dishonest in of itself. They're hypocrites. That's why I don't even waste my time arguing with them. If Jason wouldn't have never said nothing to me today, I would have never said anything about it. I would have made them wait and wait and wait and wait.
Well, if you think about it, these guys, they're not Christians, obviously. So
right.
they find Christians and Christianity boring. And so they've got to just it kind of feeds them, I think, in sort of a twisted, sort of an evil way. to goad Christians, and it's kind of like a high, you know, like almost a drug high, I think. And they got to keep being fed, and that's why I think when it kind of runs dry with the Christians, they start turning on themselves. Yeah. Because they've got to keep this high going. But they find Christianity boring, and so if they can find somebody that they can lure out of their element, then they're all over that, and then they can use that for their own advantage and say, you know, turn it around and say, hey, look at him. He's not a Christian. He's a liar. And so that's a way they can try to destroy somebody's witness. And ultimately, if they can destroy their witness, you know, it destroys the whole point of being a Christian, is spreading the gospel. And by doing that, it sort of cuts the legs out of being a Christian itself, and ultimately that's what they're after. They're looking for deconversions.
Right, and I totally agree with you. And now we're going to get to the heart of the matter, why they even care about what I said. They're trying to discredit me here on YouTube as being this liar. Again, if you go read the comments on my channel, long before this ever happened in my older videos, I've been a liar 2 years ago. I was a liar when I went outside doing evangelism the last time I went out there. I'm a liar every time I open my mouth up regarding the scripture. You know what I mean? To these people. So mm-hmm. When you start looking at it from God's perspective, and God already foresaw this since the beginning, you know what I mean? When you look at it from his perspective, what they're going to use for evil, God is going to use for good. Let me give you an example. Redline and this other guy named Suzuki Das, who's no longer on YouTube, made a claim. I'm started telling other atheists to unsubscribe to my channel, and I had another atheist tell some people to boycott my channel, to boycott my hangouts. When they did that, I watched my subscriber count go up from, like, you know, 20, 30 to like 150 when they started telling other atheists what to do. And I've learned on YouTube you can't do that with atheists. But that's what they're going to try to do. Okay? Every time they try to tell another, hey, you know, don't watch G-Man's channel no more. He's a slanderer. Then watch my subscriber count. Watch it. It's going to go up. It ain't going to go down. It's going to go up. Because atheists hate
know
what to do.
I personally, when I saw you on that J.D. Cain show and I saw all the atheists, like a pack of wolves attack you, basically, I've been watching them for the last few weeks and I just think they're childish. I just think they're so childish. And they just can't engage with you and they're just obnoxious. And I think you should be debating people like Matt DeLonte. I can't pronounce his name. People like that, that's who you should be debating, and you should be having debates with that kind of people, and staying away from this culture that they're just childish, really.
Yep.
And I agree with you. That's why I got a series of videos I'm going to be uploading refuting a lot of what Matt Delahunty says here on YouTube. I really believe I'm wasting my time dealing with the atheists that all they want to do is slander all the time and lie and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying I don't lie at times here on YouTube. I'm simply saying that it will be more fruitful for me to focus on Delahunty, Aaron Raw, the Amazing Atheist, which I have an open invitation to talk to this guy anytime I want. You know what I mean? And they're jealous of that. You know what I mean? And they don't understand the way I think. I'm not your prototypical Christian that gets on here and just read the comments and actually start caring when I get called names. The Bible says that we're going to be persecuted for his name's sake. Anyone who lives a godly life in Christ Jesus is going to be persecuted. Jesus himself was on YouTube preaching. They would call him a liar and tell him that that God doesn't exist. So, you know, they're doing what their nature is, and that's to, you know, be trolls here on YouTube. You know, and they're not being honest with themselves. Whenever they make the decision to say, you know what, there is no spiritual world, I'm not even gonna try to comprehend that that exists. Whenever you tell yourself that, you're robbing yourself out of knowledge. And they're showing they're not true seekers. They don't care about like getting smarter about anything. They just want to stay in their own little bubble. So they believe evolution's factual. Big Bang actually happened. Morality is subjective. You know, and they're a good person. When in reality, they're just as evil as I am.
And I,
you know, apart from the cross.
I want to put a challenge out to Matt Dillon, whatever his name is. If you ever listen, I challenge you to debate G-Man, and if you win the debate, I'll close all my channels down.
You know what? I'll do the same thing. I'll close all three of my channels if Matt Dillon comes to my Google Hangout and accepts a moderated debate on the topic of slavery in the Bible and prove that it's immoral. And by the way, Matt Dillahunty, you were smart for not coming on the skeptic fence. Because when you get in the same room with me with a moderator, you ain't got a chance in winning, sir. Because you won't be able to hang the phone up on me this time. I got this thing. Listen, we're all men in here, right? You're a man, Jason Burns. Tommy, you're a man, right? I'm a man. If another man challenges another man to an intellectual discussion, and we both have strong opinions about what we believe, they should take the other person on it. You know what I mean? But this guy is acting like a complete and utter coward. And he thinks, I'm going to spend the better part of 2015 reminding him of this. Listen, you don't know what you're talking about when it comes to slavery. I do. Let's have a debate about this.
Well, he's did you see him when he debated Matt Slick? And Matt Slick challenged him on theology.
I want to know that real fast.
he claimed that he'd been studying as a minister and he knew theology, so Matt Slick asked him some questions and he's like, oh, I don't know that. And or, you know, I mean, there's a difference. You know your Bible, he doesn't. And
right.
You'd win that debate, no problem, with the Lord's help. But he will step up to the mark. I think he will come and debate you, but some of these bigger names won't debate you because...
By faith, I believe that, though. I'm going to debate Matt. I know I'm going to. Yeah. I can feel it in my bones. I know he's going to debate me. I just need to get ready for it when it happens. Because he is a slickster, if you know what I mean.
And you're going to lose, bro. You're going to lose, Matt. You're going to lose big time, bro.
Everyone knows it. Even the atheists that watch my channel knows Matt better not debate me. You know, and I get great satisfaction out of that because they can lie in the chat all they want. But when they try to use his same arguments against me in a Google Hangout and their arguments are getting slapped all over the place, you know what I mean? The truth of God's word is being glorified. You know what I mean? They know it just like I know. Matt needs to stay on the atheist experience and then stay as far away from G-Man as possible. You know, and by the way, Matt, I second that challenge. Matt, I challenge you to a debate on whether or not slavery is moral or immoral. I mean, you made it look so easy, according to you, on the Atheist Experience when I called. Or do I need to call your show and challenge you on your own program and show how much of a coward you are? Because I'm really thinking about doing that.
Well, what they'll do for the next few weeks, they'll start talking more about slander and say, or G-Man slandering and trying to get out of it. But eventually, he'll step up to the mark.
Exactly. I'm hoping to get on the Magic Sandwich Show and talk to Aaron Raw again and bring that up to him about the slavery in the Bible. By the way, did you see when I had my little mini discussion with him?
On the Magic Sandwich Show?
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, and he didn't really know much about the Bible or anything like that.
Yeah, Aaron Raw is a legend in his own mind. He just kept making all these claims, and when I asked him to back him up, he couldn't do it. He was right because he said he was right. You know what I mean? So
Aaron Raw's got delusions of grandeur. That's his problem. Matt Slick, when he debated him, at the end of that debate, he was shaking his head, and he said he'd never met a more deluded atheist in all the debates he's ever had. That's how deluded Aaron Rahn is. The guy is so deluded, he kind of thinks he's some kind of great intellectual, and yet when anybody talks to him, any Christian talks to him, we kind of talk to him in shock because there's just nothing there. So,
I have another little challenge I like to throw out there. The highest level of schooling that I have is about 1 year in college. That's when I stopped and I decided I'm sick of school. But Fiona has a PhD, I believe, in biology, right? I would love to have a debate with Fiona on the following topic. Are Roman Catholics Christians, or are Roman Catholics saved? Fiona, that is a challenge, Fiona. Are you going to make me look smart by running and showing everybody that yellow stripe you got down your spine? Or are you going to be an example to the atheist community and the Catholic community and actually show up and have that moderated debate? And by the way, Fiona, if you need a moderator, just for kicks and strictly for entertainment, I'll even let Alex Botton be the moderator. That is how confident I am that you are going to get destroyed. Because I'm 100% sure you don't know nothing about Roman Catholicism or about what I believe. But you know a lot about biology. That's about it. That's a challenge, Fiona. I'd like to hear what you got to say. In video, if you don't mind.
Oh, G-Man. Oh, G-Man, I don't do debates with you, G-Man. Oh, I can't debate you. You're slandering me, G-Man. And that Richard Raspberry's after me. That Richard Raspberry's after me. And I can't debate you, G-Man, because you'd have to give me a train ticket to debate you.
If you maybe I have Jason, to buy her a new computer or machine.
If you and Jason and Tommy Hall get me a train ticket, I might debate you.
You heard that, Fiona? What are you going to do about that, Fiona? Ignore me or just leave some goofy comment in the chat, which is all you ever do. And Tommy, I like to say something to you face to face. I didn't like what Shani for Christ did with you in that hangout. I went in there and I asked her straight up, show me some justification in the scripture for what you did. They didn't let you talk. They accused you of all this stuff. I'm a viewer watching this. I don't know what's going on, and you ain't saying anything. You know she admitted that she was wrong, right?
Well, I know she admitted that that she slept around while she was married. And so
well, I don't know nothing about that. I don't know nothing okay, about well, that. I don't understand why I'm not letting you answer.
Well, okay. I'm just saying that's what she said. So, so why she called me a liar, along with other choice words, I still don't know. She says it's not like I thought it was, but I'm not going to say a whole lot about it. But I will say that I have apologized before, but I'll just apologize for bringing it up. I mean, it was childish and. But it was kind of on the heels. I just see her as, it was just kind of hypocritical that she was coming down so hard on Rand for you know his endeavors when she's got her own past to deal with, and it was really bothering me. And that what I said was what happened on the day after. Rand made his video, his repentance video, which I thought was very good, and I honestly think there was something there. I thought he was being truthful, and then not just a few minutes later, Shani came out, and I don't remember exactly what it was, but she was just like, kind of trashing it, not believing. What are you going to do now, Rand? And it was just it really ticked me off. And I haven't been that ticked off on here in a long time. And so it was kind of on the heels of that I was talking to Shani, and, you know, she brought up the whole, you know, sex before marriage thing, and I just sort of blurted it out on chat. But I regret it now. I mean, whether it happened or not is really beside the point. So, I mean, I've apologized, but it's
well,
just,
Shani,
it's,
I'm sorry, guys.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, with Shani, I think the issue with her is that she's just having a bunch of emotional outbursts. See, here's the thing. I believe that she's a Christian. I just believe that she stopped making this her foundation. This is not her foundation. It can't be. You know what I mean? I think whatever she feels, she does. And I'm gonna talk about this from experience. Sometimes, as a matter of fact, watching Talking Stuff Tuesdays was a knee-jerk reaction when I decided to go in there. I mean, I knew that it was a bad idea to go in there, but I decided to go in there and challenge JBK and then ultimately leave, you know, without really, like, really thinking it through. You know, it was just unwise. But I know what it's like to make a knee-jerk emotional, you know, a decision. And if you remember, all of this stuff started when she made the video about Brett King, and I was there, Becca was there, all of us was there complaining about, you know, you know, about his actions that he did at the time. And Rand came in there, and he was very angry because he didn't like the fact about us talking about an in-house issue with atheists. Okay, and I understood his perspective. That's why I didn't say anything to him. But I think Shani was hurt emotionally because of it and then went after him. That's what that's why I think she's doing what she's doing, and I think she's starting to see it now.
Well, I'd like to say one more thing about that. Is, you know, that video hangout that I was on with Shani. Obviously, Shani and pink hair, Hillary, were going bananas and cussing at me. But other than the comment about the sexual stuff, I had nothing to do with. I really have nothing to do with any of that. You know, they were yelling at me for and not letting me talk and acting like I was somehow guilty of something. But I have no really. It had nothing to do with me at all, and so that's another thing. I was just kind of uncomfortable and didn't really know what to say because it really had nothing to do with me. I had no inside knowledge. She contacted me about nothing. I never talked to her. I never talked to anybody else about any of that. So it was just, you know, it was just I was just kind of sitting there like a lame duck and didn't know what to say. But ultimately, it had nothing to do with me. So I still don't understand what the outburst was for.
I saw it. I popped in and had a look at it. He told me about it, and I went to have a look. And I was like in shock. I really was. I was like, it's like somewhere out of Amar House of Horrors, these two women going on and on and on at Tommy. And I've talked to you quite a bit, and I know that you're a really nice guy. So when I saw them ripping into you, I just thought, this is just so utter nonsense. And all they're trying to do is just drag a decent guy, who's a really nice guy, he does really nice stuff, just one of the politest people that you could talk to, and they just want to drag him through the mud. And that's all they want to do.
I think they just needed a punching bag, and I was there. And I, you know, what I said to her sort of set off the firestorm, which, you know, if she ever did apologize, I would forgive her. And I do pray for her, and I just, you know, echo. I forgot who said it, but I do think she's a Christian. She just needs to. I don't understand the hanging around with the atheist thing. I've seen her. She kind of cozies up with Hillary a lot, and I've seen her in various chats, and she makes various comments on the chats about how we need to do this or we need to do that, and she's talking to the atheists who are in the chat with her. So I don't understand any of that, but I do believe people backslide. She just needs to do some praying.
I know, looking at it from my perspective and reading the comments after you went on there and watching some of her videos, yeah, the atheists know what they're doing. They're definitely trying to reel her in. But I know what I said to her was true. And I said, listen, even if you do become an atheist and somehow you lose your faith, they're going to like you for about a week. Mm-hmm. Then they're going to throw you under the bus as soon as you start opening your mouth the way you do as a Christian. So if I were you, I would check what's going on my channel, watch what the atheists are doing, that they're trying to divide and conquer. Okay, I would repent, and then I would just be more careful who I'm listening to. You know, because these atheists, they don't care about Aunt Shani. Yeah. I don't know about her relationship with Hillary. I can't speak for her. But the other atheists here on YouTube, I don't think they care about Shani. You know, these are the same people that I was poking fun on her regarding her believing that there was no moon. And granted, don't get me wrong, I thought that was a little silly when I heard that too. But I don't think there's anything mentally wrong with her because she doesn't believe that there's no moon, you know.
I just want to come in because I've been watching, because I'm not on as much as I used to, I've been watching a lot of Google Hangouts, and the atheists spend 95% of the time just talking about Ron Campbell, everybody else, everybody. They just, it's like the only thing they do is talk about individuals. And I think that we've done a bit of talking about a few individuals. And I think I'd like us to talk about, just for the remaining time, maybe a topic that...
Go ahead, finish. Please finish. I didn't mean to interrupt.
I just think that we've got all that stuff out of the way about Fiona and Alex and stuff like that, and it'd be nice to make sure that we end on focusing, like, I mean, you man brought in the gospel before, but that we focus on maybe a theological topic or something that we could just talk about for the next few minutes, just to end on something more and get people to focus on that. If that's okay, guys.
Yeah, I guess I would just like to say, just in light of G-Man and me and other Christians, you know, and Shani, all of us really, we're all in the same boat together, but I think we all need to remember that God wants us to be holy, and that, you know, we Christians, even though we come on here and joke around and have fun, you know, we're supposed to be representing Christ. But we're set aside, you know, for him. And as y'all know, I mean, holiness, personal holiness, is so rare. And you know, it's very much of a contrast on here, I think. You know, when you see the actions of the atheists, then you see, to me, it's very refreshing to see the Christians and how they hold themselves. And but we can all do a better job, especially me. Probably me at the top, actually. But so I guess that's the main thing. I think, and my other thing is for myself is I get carried away with just, you know, like I said earlier, poking jabs at people is kind of pleasurable in a way for the atheist, because it's kind of fun to jab them. And but ultimately, self pleasure is destructive and can be, if you don't, well, it is destructive. And I think the only way to true peace and love and walking with Christ is to focus on Him. So anyway, that was all.
I can piggyback off what you just said. I like to use Vackel as an example. Vackel seems to be at least the first person that comes to my mind in my circles who, can I put this, who practices humility while going after the atheist. Vackel's one of the few Christians on YouTube I know that will actually sit back and listen to a lot of this blasphemous stuff for a long period of time and not say anything. He'll be like, I didn't know that. And he'll do that for like a long time and then come back with something biblical to try to refute what they're saying. Or if he doesn't know something, he'll be honest and just admit it. Vackel's practicing humility. He's practicing being like Christ. He's practicing holiness. You know what I mean? And I think that's something that we ought to be striving for. Yeah. And it's not because that we're these, you know, moral agents of God and we don't never do nothing wrong. No, it just means that we are saved sinners and that we're following the teachings of Christ and that we're growing and that we're striving. We're working towards being like Christ. It's a process. Okay? And this is going to be a process until we stand before Almighty God on that glorious day when he returns. So if there was something I would want the people that are watching this to take away from this, just understand when you're dealing with a Christian, we're not claiming to be perfect. We're not claiming that we don't mess up. We do a lot of dumb things. Okay? But it is by the power of Almighty God through Jesus Christ, by the blood that he shed on the cross, and by his divine revelation, the Word of God, the Bible, and by His Holy Spirit, that we know that we ought not to be doing this, but we ought to be loving, merciful, caring individuals who's all about our Father's business. You know what I mean? And it's Tommy's right. It's just so easy to so easy to get off the narrow road and pop on a broad road, and then get back on a narrow road. Yeah. It's like, you just want to strangle these atheists sometimes.
Yeah.
Stuff at these things. But at the end of the day, we have to recognize that. We have to repent. And we have to live the way God has called us to live. And if I can say something directly to the people who might be watching this, I have no idea how many of you are out there. But I do want to say this. A lot of times when you guys are talking to myself, Tommy, Jason, Vekel, and other Christians here on YouTube, Rand Campbell, etc. You guys need to understand that we know you're trying to lead us somewhere in the conversation. But just know this, we're doing the same thing. So don't act like we're doing anything like that's just so wrong when you're doing it yourself. You're going to make yourself look bad when you do that. The best thing to do is to be straight up and be honest. Look, I don't agree that your God exists, okay? I believe that you're delusional, and I'm going to try to talk you into stop believing in this God. Just be straight up and honest, because I already know that's the case when I'm talking to you. And just know up front that when I talk to you, when we're having a great debate conversation, then my goal is to win you for Christ, because I believe that you're spiritually dead, that the wages of and because you're spiritually dead and you're a sinner, that the wages of your sin is death, that separation from God and being thrown into the lake of fire. But, you know, I want you to come to know Jesus Christ so that you can have eternal life. Yeah. You know, and at the end of the day, just be honest about where we're coming from and stop playing all the word games.
Amen. Okay, guys, I've got a couple of thoughts to play this. How long, guys, have you got left? How long do you reckon you'd be staying for, G-Man? Another 5, 10, 20 minutes? Or...
I've got no plans.
I got groceries that I need to put up. I just wanted to come in here and talk about the whole, you know, UK situation, the whole Fiona thing, yeah, whatever. So
you've got 15 minutes to spur, G-Man.
Yeah, I can stick around. Yeah, sure. I'll put the groceries up later. Okay.
Well, what do you want to need? Would you like me to throw some questions at you both to answer theological questions, or would you prefer me to send out a link and invite people in?
I would prefer you ask me and Tommy questions. I am not in the mood for I'm not in the mood for the atheist.
Give me the easy ones.
Well, I'm going to ask you some questions.
Demon gets the hard ones.
Basically, question for anyone who's like a young Christian. So, you know, imagine you were doing a Bible study and you were helping young Christians. So these are questions that you could put to a young Christian, but I'm going to put them for you to answer for someone who's inquiring or is a young Christian. Okay?
Okay.
How do you know that you have eternal life?
Is that for Tommy or me?
Go ahead, G-Man.
Okay, I love this. By the power of God's Holy Spirit, there's a reason why I know. His spirit confirms with my spirit that I have eternal life. The fact that I have a changed life, I know who I was before I became a Christian. The fact that I'm completely and totally different is evidence that I'm born again. I take Jesus Christ at his word. He says that he who believes is not condemned, but he who believes not is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So I believe. And I believe based on the fact that my prayers are being answered. I believe based on the revelation of God's word. I believe based on God's spirit confirming with my spirit that I am who I say I am, and that is a believer. And a whole plethora of other reasons. But the scripture is probably the strongest evidence I have, where it teaches about the sinner, and it teaches about the redeemed person who's saved. So, and my changed life is evidence of that. If any of you knew me before I became a believer, you would be amen and amen like crazy.
Amen. Tommy, what you got to say, bro?
Boy, I couldn't have answered that well. But yeah, I would like to echo. I mean, for me, it is my personal relationship, which is just as real as my a relationship with well, even more real, but it's in a sense it's real in the sense of as I have with anybody else. And so that's why it can never be shaken. That's why I know it's real. It's something I could have never faked, I could have never made up. And for me, it's just the blood of Christ is the only thing that's real for me, and it's a very personal thing. But I don't know how to say it, but I guess that's all. I've got my thoughts screwed up.
Okay, next question. I've got quite a few questions, so you got to.
Okay.
Who is Jesus?
I can answer that if you want, Tommy, or you can do it.
Yeah, go ahead.
Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Christ. He is the only begotten Son of God. He is the one who died for the sins of humanity. Jesus is also God. And when he came here, he was half man. He was half God. The doctrine of the incarnation. Jesus is the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. He's going to rule with a rod of iron. And you keep letting me talk, you're never going to get a chance to go, Tommy. Go ahead. He's my Lord and Savior. Go ahead, Tommy.
Yeah, Jesus is the Son of God. He was born of a virgin and lived on this earth for about three decades and was crucified, died on the cross, and is the Savior for all sin, including everyone's sin. And what he did on the cross covers everyone's sin, and he is the hope, and he is the salvation, and he is who we are going to be joining with when we die, and we're going to be spending eternity with him. And so, yeah, he ultimately is Lord and Christ and Redeemer. And so that's what he is.
Next question. Is Jesus the only way to God?
John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Yes, he is the only way to the Father.
Amen. Is the Christian faith based on any facts?
You might want to let Tommy do this because you're going to have me talking for a half an hour. Yes. Go ahead, Tommy.
Well, I mean, goodness gracious. Maybe I'm mixing up facts and evidence. But I would say definitely there's that the Bible is full of evidence of who God is. And how we are supposed to live our lives, and but it is a history. It is also a history. It is it's just a I don't know that facts are the appropriate word. I mean, I think because like the Bible, you know, there's 40 different authors, and there's all kinds of different stories and lots of different people from lots of different walks of life have written. And, you know, some people are going to believe it and some people are not. Mm. Now, if you get into archaeology or something, you could show facts, but I don't know, you know, some people may still claim that that's evidence. So I guess the word fact is what's sort of tripping me up here. I think G-Man's probably going to set me straight.
No, I'm not going to set you straight. I'm gonna try to answer it a little bit. I just didn't want to talk forever. Okay, number one, Jesus Christ was a real person. I think that's already been established. There's too much history to support the fact that as a matter of fact, there's not enough evidence to prove that he didn't exist. I'll put it to you that way. Especially when we look at history, archaeology, and a bunch of other things and whatnot. I would say, let's look at one of the major facts that the Bible, one of the claims that the Bible makes, and that's that we're all sinners. I have never met a person who wasn't guilty of the things that God says that he would call sin. For example, I've never met an individual who's never lied. I've never met an individual who's never stolen anything, even if it was something small out of somebody else's house. I've never met an individual who hasn't looked at another woman. I mean, unless they their genitals are cut off or something like that, or something along those lines. But I've never met an individual who's never lusted after another person. And all these things just proves that we're sinners. You know what I mean? And by the way, I've never met a perfect person either, who never messed up. Mm-hmm. For those of the people who are really smart and watching this and trying to find reasons or whatever. So I believe that what the Bible says about sin is correct, and the consequences of sin. I believe we see it in our political, not in our political system, in our justice system. You know, a lot of people have a hard time understanding hell and the lake of fire. Hell is a holding cell. The lake of fire is for eternity. When you go to a holding cell, we might call that county. But when you go to prison, you could potentially stay there for 500 years. I mean, if you could live that long, depending on how many life sentences you can get. But you can also be punished to death too when you're thrown into prison. You get the death penalty, which is what God's going to do. You know, so I see a plethora of this stuff in scripture. Two of the most prominent things is being some of the historical figures mentioned in Christianity, and then two, the fact that we all have sinned and has fallen short of the glory of God.
Amen. One more question, and then I've got a video clip to show you guys, and I'd like your thoughts on the clip.
Okay.
The last question is, what advice would you give a young Christian to grow their faith? If a young Christian came to you, someone who's recently got converted, and said to you, I want to grow in my faith, what advice would you give them of how to do that?
Well, I would... That's funny you ask that, because I, here in the past, really, couple months, have, you know, prayed about that and have asked God to help me grow in Him. And I would say that the biggest thing that I've done with His help is to just put myself in the Word and to take myself, I was going to say out of the world. You can't really do that, but you can not hang around certain people who are of the world. So I guess the main thing is you just have to put yourself in the Word more, and you have to, I need to be around believers, and I need to pray. And so I guess those are the three main things. And it's just amazing the change that God can make in you when you do, as I said before, sort of flee from yourself and you cling to Him. And so I guess that's the main thing I would tell a young Christian is just, first of all, to pray, to put yourself around, be around other Christians, and to put yourself in the Word of God.
Yeah, that's pretty much the same thing I'm going to say. Pretty much spend as much time with God and other believers as possible. And look at their example, follow their example, and spend a lot of time in God's Word. Ask a lot of questions. That's what I would do.
What would you say to that, Jason?
I would say the same. I'd say read the Bible, fellowship with the Lord's people, attend the means of grace, that is the preaching of the Word, communion, serve the Lord, get involved in serving, give to the Lord's work. Those are some of the things that I would say.
I forgot two things that were really important.
I'm sorry, Tommy, before you go, I'm sorry. Jason, can you give me the YouTube link to this Google Hangout?
Yeah.
I just want to read the comments.
The other two things I would say would be to follow the commandments and to repent. And so I would add that to that list.
Amen.
I'm just getting the... I'm just trying to send a link to...
I want to put a comment in the chat to let everyone know that I talked about the Fiona thing on this Hangout. So you're going to get a lot of traffic over here, Jason, if you want that kind of attention.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to put the clip on now, and then I've sent a link to Richard Rathby. He might come on. But if you could mute... Well, this clip's a very important clip, and I'd really like your opinion about this clip, so I'll just put it on if I can find it.
Folks, I'm tired of hearing about revival.
tired of hearing about awakenings. Of last day outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I've heard that rhetoric for 50 years. Just rhetoric. No meaning whatsoever. I'm tired of hearing about people in the church who say they want their unsaved loved ones saved. I'm tired of hearing people say I'm concerned about my troubled marriage when it's just talk, rhetoric. And I look at the whole religious scene today, and all I see are the inventions and ministries of man and flesh. It's mostly powerless. It has no impact on the world. And I see more of the world coming into the church and impacting the church rather than the church impacting the world. I see the music taking over the house of God. I see entertainment taking over the house of God. An obsession with entertainment in God's house, a hatred of correction and a hatred of reproof. Nobody wants to hear it anymore. Whatever happened to anguish in the house of God? Whatever happened to anguish in the ministry? It's a word you don't hear in this pampered age. You don't hear it. Anguish means extreme pain and distress. The emotion so stirred that it becomes painful. Acute, deeply felt inner pain because of conditions about you, in you or around you. Anguish. Deep pain. Deep sorrow. Agony of God's heart. We've held on to our religious rhetoric and our revival talk, but we've become so passive. Our so-called awakenings, our stirrings, last but a short time, and when the short-lived revivings and awakenings come from the hand of God, they are so short-lived, and in those times we promise God we'll never return to our passivity. But it's not long, it's just weeks or months, and we're back, and this time we slip further back into passivity than when we started. I speak from experience. And we say, this time, oh God, you've touched me for life. I'll never be the same. And it's like fireworks. A loud bang and a lot of noise, and then it dies. All true passion is born out of anguish. All true passion for Christ comes out of a baptism of anguish. You search the scripture and you'll find that when God determined to recover a ruined situation, he would seek out a praying man and he'd take him down into the waters of anguish. He would share his own anguish for what God saw happening to his church and to his people, and he would find a praying man and he would take that man and literally baptize him in anguish. Now, I believe in the love of God. I've preached mercy, grace, and love, covenant of love. I believe in preaching the goodness and long-suffering of Christ. But multitudes today are being saturated with your okay messages. We've got people now that are turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. We've become like the children of Israel who said the right words. But here's what God said. I've heard the words of this people. They have well said all that they have spoken, all that there was such a heart in them, that they would fear me and keep my commandments always, that it might be well with them and with their children forever. He said, oh, you have the right words. You sing the right song, but your heart is not right. You find it in the book of Nehemiah, Jerusalem, is it ruins. Here was a delegation from the ruined city of Jerusalem coming to Nehemiah. It said, Jerusalem is broken down. The walls are down. There's ruin, nothing but ruin. Now, these I'm sure were godly men. These were good men, but they had no concept of how God was going to deal with the situation, how he was going to bring about a recovery. Why didn't they have an answer? Why didn't God use them in restoration? Why didn't they have a word? Because there was no sign of anguish. No weeping. Not a word of prayer. It's all ruin. When I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. You see, God found a praying man, and he takes him down into the waters of baptism of anguish. This man goes down into anguish. And God found a man who would not just have a flash of emotion, not just some great sudden burst of concern and then let it die. You see, we face a similar situation, except ours is many times worse. Does it matter to you today? Does it matter to you at all that God's spiritual Jerusalem, the church, is now married to the world? There's such a coldness sweeping the land. So many people I know that were my friends, and I see them go one by one, husbands and wives, into such passivity. Going to churches where they can find smooth messages, no longer wanting to hear anything of wrath or of correction. Some of my closest friends, I see them falling by the wayside, and the cry is it nothing to you? Closer than that, does it matter about the Jerusalem that's in our own hearts? The sign of ruin that's slowly draining spiritual power and passion. Blind to lukewarmness. Blind to the mixture that's creeping in. You see, when spiritual blindness comes, very few recognize it. It's the last recognized thing that happens to the child of God. In all honesty, there are numbers among us that are changing, and they don't know it. You've lost your fight, so you won't labor in prayer anymore. You won't weep before God anymore. You can sit and watch television and your family go to hell. Does it really matter to you that your unsaved loved ones are dying and we're getting closer and closer to the end? Does it really concern you? They could die and go to hell. Even though you're a lover of Christ. Where's the anguish? Where are the tears? Where's the mourning? Where's the fasting? I know now. Oh my God, do I know it. Until I'm in agony. Until I have been anguished over it. I'm preaching sermons. Oh God, I'm preaching sermons. Then I said, no, it's too late. I don't have that much time. And all our projects, all our ministries, everything we do, where are the Sunday school teachers that weep over kids they know are not hearing and they're going to hell? I know now it's going to take more than preaching, more than a new revelation. There's going to be no renewal, no revival, no awakening, but terrible willing to let him once again break us. Folks, it's getting late and it's getting serious. Please don't tell me. Don't tell me you're concerned. Don't tell me that you want your unsafe loved one saved when you're spending hours in front of internet or television. Come on. There's some need to get this altar and confess. I am not what I was. I am not where I'm supposed to be. God, I don't have your heart or your burden. I wanted it easy. Just want to be happy. There's nothing of the flesh will give you joy. I don't care how much money, I don't care what kind of new house there is. Absolutely nothing physical can give you joy. It's only what is accomplished by the Holy Spirit when you obey Him and take on His heart. It gives you the knowing of His voice, that instant knowledge, God saying, this is the way, walk in it. And then the wonderful joy of seeing God answer your prayer. Build the walls around your family. Build the walls around your own heart. Make you strong and impregnable against the enemy. God, that's what we desire.
Amen.
Sounds like he's asking, where's that passion?
Yeah.
You know, to go out there, and do, not talk about, but to go out there and do what we're called to do. It's a good word. I tell people all the time, you know, the reason why I you know, get on here and let people attack me so much, and do the things that they're doing, is because I have a passion for the reason why I'm here. Like, for example, I'm here to expose the lies about the last days that's causing people to fall away. And if I got to be called dumb, stupid, whatever, if it means that my reputation has to be thrown through the mud and all of that, I don't really care at the end of the day. What I care about is going out there and spreading those seeds, and spreading the gospel so that people can know the truth, to know that it is possible to stand up against, you know, the practicality of the devil. You know what I mean? Look bad on YouTube, at least according to the world, but still be faithful to Almighty God. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
While doing it.
Amen.
Nobody says...
Oh, sorry, Jimmy.
Yeah, he was talking about being baptized into anguish. I agree with that. You do got to come to a place where you're just sick and tired of just being sick and tired. You know what I mean? And just looking at all this. You know what I mean? Watching your brothers and your sisters be lied to by people. You know, by the various cults or whatever. You know what I mean? Are you okay, Jason? Need some water or something? But yeah, when you get to that place where you're sick and tired of just being sick and tired, you know what I mean, and you're tired of watching your brothers and your sisters be deceived, you know, by lies, you're going to do whatever it is that's necessary. Go out there and preach the good news.
I think it's a two-sided coin, though, because we are to be joyful as well. So, and you said the word exactly, that the word I was thinking of was passion, you know, that we all lack that. To some one degree or another. And that really hits home, you know, about your friends and your neighbors and your family, that, you know, we do claim to want to spread the gospel, and we do things, you know, he was talking about the flesh, and that does not equal joy, but we kind of do things for our own pleasure and our own entertainment, and we're not out spreading the gospel. Probably, you know, a large portion of our day is either spent working or some just resting or entertainment. And how much of the day does the average person go out and actually witness? It's not very much. and or spread the gospel. So yeah, it's that I just took it as a wake up call, as to just be passionate about who you are, you know, what you believe, and that God put us here for a reason. That was to glorify Him and to spread the gospel.
Amen.
Richard, are you here, bro?
Yeah, hello guys, how's it going?
Hello,
yeah,
Richard.
Good to see you.
Sorry, Jason.
Good to see you, mate.
Do
you want to share anything about the video, mate?
I caught only, I don't know if it was halfway through, but it was hard to jump in straight away from, the video was going as I came in, but something I did pick up on, I like Dave Wilkerson, but I know he's very an emotional preacher, and I think that's good. I think it's good because we're very emotional people. But what he said about losing salvation, about your family dying around you, going to hell, I don't know if I necessarily agree with it, because it's if to say that, you know, the gift of what Christ did to you once you believe on that and start seeking Christ is something Christ is going to take away from you. It's just to say Jesus is dangling a carrot in front of your head like a donkey. I don't really agree with that. I think as, you know, people who've been saved and born again in Christ, we're ever seeking to seek righteousness and His riches in wisdom. And that's really to God's glory, and it really perfects it perfects Him to us and makes us realize how good God is. But I don't really think it can make us lose salvation unless, you know, you're one of those people who go the complete opposite way, like some people who say they were once Christians, but I don't believe in once were Christians. I think they once were religious people, but I don't think you can actually say I was once born again and now I'm not. I mean, for example, you know, your friend Alex Botton claims he was once born again, and when I asked him what does being born again mean, he said it means being, you know, getting wet in some water. But Christ says you must be born again in water and of the Spirit, you know, and it's the, you must recognize what Jesus actually says. You right, Jason?
Yeah, sorry. I've had a cold all day.
Oh, oh dear. It's going around at the moment, isn't it?
what I got out of it, what spoke to me is the superficiality of Christendom and how to seek God in prayer and to get God's heart on a situation and to see it from God's angle, and that God's heart breaks with the superficiality, with the coldness, and to be concerned and burdened for praying that the Lord's people would awake. That's what I got out of it.
But the thing is, if you have the heart of God, then you're going to be willing to take the bumps, you know, when you're out there doing ministry. You know what I mean? A lot of times people will, I don't know, start a YouTube channel, go out there and do outdoor evangelism, and they try to share the faith, and as soon as they run into trouble, they're running the other way, because they're not looking at this from God's perspective. They're doing what they thought what was right. The person has the heart of God, and they're looking at everything from His perspective. You know, the lost is going to, you know, be tormented day and night in the lake of fire. Yeah. Those who are saved and have eternal life, you know, these people are going to just suffer so much more to try to get people into the kingdom. Yeah, Tommy, I'm sorry I interrupted
you. Yeah, exactly. I was going to say it, but well, I was going to ask Jason, what did you think of what I said about joy? Because, you know, having anguish over the lost is, I don't know why I'm struggling with this. To me, it seems like that's not a particularly productive emotion, especially if you're trying to win hearts for the Lord. I mean, to me, joy is the if you want to err on the side of anything, it should be on joy, and not looking at that. I mean, to me, the other side of the coin being anguish is, I don't know that it's something you should strive for. I know what he's trying to say. I think he's just trying to say that we should have a fire under us, I guess, which is true. And we should have a passion, like what G-Man said. But, maybe you can explain it better. I just don't know that anguish is what, especially, and how can you, if you're not truly feeling anguish, how do you fake that? I mean, you can't fake it. So how do you get that?
I know what you're saying, because like Paul says in Philippians chapter 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord, and again I say rejoice. And in the presence of God is the fullness of joy. So I know what you're saying, because but at the same time, Paul talks about my heart's desire that I would long to be, he talks about that he longs that he would be glad to lose his own life if only it would save others, his own people. You know what I mean? So they're not mutually antithetical. They're not opposed to each other. You can have the joy of the Lord, but at the same time, you can have the burden and concern. I mean, if you look at Paul's life, I mean, he had joy, but he was burdened for his own people. You look at our Lord. You know, I mean, he's God. So, I mean, obviously, he's got joy, but you know, he wept over Jerusalem and said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I long that to gather you, you know, as a chick gathers a hen. So he had that longing, you know, and so it's not, they don't have to be in tension.
Yeah, maybe it's kind of like, I'm sorry, I'll just say this real quick. Maybe it's kind of like if you have a child, and let's just say the child is sick, it's got cancer or something, you would be burdened. And you would want to do anything to save that child. And so, you know, maybe that's kind of one way to look at it.
Yeah.
I look at it like this. Mm-hmm. And I believe in 1 Corinthians it talks about how the body of Christ is made up of different parts. See, I understand what I think Tommy is saying about joy. You're going to have some people have different motivations for preaching the gospel. Some people are just going to feel a certain way about the loss. They're going to have like a very, very, very heavy heart for the loss, and it's going to appear to be anguish for them. Some people are just going to be overwhelmed with joy because they have been saved. I mean, look at what God did for me. Look at what he forgave me of. Look what he's done to me. Take a look at what my God is doing with me. You know what I mean? And then you'll have some other people who will be motivated because of prophecy. You got people who are motivated for various reasons. So I don't think David Wilkerson wrong for saying that that some people need to, you know, anguish over it. But I don't know if that's true for all of us, because we all got our different reasons why we're here on YouTube and why we, you know, this is a ministry in general, like in our own personal lives and everything. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Can I say something? Because earlier on I was listening to you guys before I got the link, and I was talking about you guys saying, you know, about the, just I heard G-Man just then, you know, you just commenting about the motivation. I think I heard earlier Tommy saying about Christianity becoming boring, and I think
wait a second. I was just saying that the atheist is boring.
Oh, okay.
I don't think I said Christianity is boring. The atheists see us as boring, and they see Christianity as boring.
Sure. Okay. Absolutely. I mean, yeah. Yes. I mean, because. Because the amazing, well, I mean, that's a whole other thing, but I will just quickly say, I mean, you know as well as I do, Christianity sounds incredibly simple to people when they hear it, but it's one of those things which is so amazingly, it's so amazing once you realize the truth of it and the continuous truth of it. So although it sounds superficially simple on the outside. Once you really dig into the meat of it, you realise how deep it goes, sort of thing. So, yeah. But about joy. I mean, in Philippians, he says, "Rejoice in the Lord always." And again, I say rejoice. It's about rejoicing always in the Lord. And again, it says later on. It says, previously it says, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." And, you know, I think it's in Romans it talks about how seeking knowledge and understanding and how this glorifying the Lord and seeking knowledge and understanding. I think we all here, you know, we all have a passion for seeking giving for providing good reasons for why we believe what we believe, even if that's individually or as a whole, if we're talking about Christianity as a whole or individually why we believe what we believe, but be it if it's scientifically or theologically or through some other, you know, sort of, you know, natty way of going about it, I think we all enjoy seeking the Lord in, for example, the greatness of God, how good that is to say, I know what is right and what is wrong because God has already prescribed what is right and what is wrong, and how that relates to the social system in which we live. I mean, we can look at murder of a child and say, that is absolutely wrong. You know, you're taking a pair of scissors to the inside of a female's womb. You know, you're chopping up a child. You can say definitively, that is wrong. Whereas an atheist, they can't say that is wrong unless they lean upon the theism in order to get to that morality. And of course, we understand that. But someone looking at it from the external will say, no, 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 and try and poo-poo it. But I think, you know, the joy of the Lord is really such a great gift for us. I mean, we can really relish in how great God is. I mean, you can look out at the skies in the day or the night and see, this is the hand of my Father. You know, whereas the atheist or the non-believer or, you know, a person who's maybe not so reading in their Bible might look at the Bible, might look at the same things we look at and think, well, you know, that's awfully complicated. That's kind of, you know, it's boring, like you say, or, you know, whatever.
Well, you said something that, it was about the, it was about the simple thing. And, you know, simplicity very often goes along with beauty and truth. They all kind of, they sometimes form a triangle. So that's one of the things that really drew me into Christianity. And it's because it is so, so very simple. I mean, you don't need a PhD to understand that Jesus lived and died, you know, for our sins, that we are sinners. It's very simple to understand. Now, obviously, you can dig into it, and it's kind of like an ocean, you know. You can look at an ocean, and it's just big and beautiful, but there's a lot underneath, you know, and I think that's what God's Word is. And so, anyway, I just kind of triggered that thought that, to me, I celebrate simplicity. I love it. And so I think it's a good thing. And I know atheists, a lot of them, they're kind of repulsed by simplicity, but I personally celebrate it.
Yeah, me too. I celebrate simplicity. Especially, you know, when it comes to science and stuff, atheists always say, well, you know, have you got a PhD in this, that, the other? I think that doesn't really matter. I mean, anyone can read. Anyone who can read can look up the literature for themselves and see where the evidence goes. It really is a black and white matter. When you look at the evidence, we're seeing grand design. And, you know, scripturally, if looking at historically on that basis, we're seeing Jesus. You know, we're seeing, if you look at the Jewish religion, you're seeing Jesus is the answer. And, you know, you want to reach out and talk to those people. If you're looking at the Islamic people, you can see, well, yes, they've completely gone off astray, but Jesus is their answer. If you look at atheists who are completely saying, well, I don't believe that, it's too simple, it's too, you know, religious and boring, whatever. Well, we need to explain to them how and why Jesus is their answer and why that is. But it is simple. I mean, Jesus calls us to be like children, and it is a wonderful thing to really take joy in, that we can be like children, in that we can celebrate and, you know, be happy in the Lord without having to be all this, you know, this over the top boringness, I suppose you call it. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've sent a link out to Jumpman Dropout application of P, so I don't know if they'll come on, but I'm just muting myself because I keep coughing, guys.
Well, I probably better. I was just gonna say I probably better peel away. I've got to go spend a little time with family here.
Okay.
So I'm gonna keep it on and listen to this. So, but yeah, I really appreciate you guys, and I think this has been great. This whole hangout. So I don't know how long it's been, but I've loved all of it. So I think it's been awesome. So it's great to spend time with you, Jason. And Richard and G-Man, and love you guys, and so y'all take care, and I will. We need to get together and do this again.
Okay, bro. God bless you, Tommy.
All right.
God bless Tommy.
All right.
Mate. Do you mind if I send the invite out to everybody, Richard, and just like one or two on, or?
No, I don't mind. Yeah, you're good. You carry on.
Comes in. We just have a talk for 10 minutes and then.
So, Jace, we haven't spoken in a while. How you been keeping? You been keeping well?
Yeah, I'm fine, bro. Yeah, it's best day. Moment, mate.
Yeah, oh, praise God.
Good day. I'm involved in church quite a lot at the moment, and
fantastic.
Yeah, no, things are good, mate. And how about you, bro?
Yeah, things are good. Yeah. I'm just keeping my head down in the Word, you know. I mean, the Bible is the best book to convict, to guide, to instruct. I mean, it's the best book to keep my head down in. Hey. Oh, bless you.
So I've sent the invite out. I don't know if it'll come in, mate.
Yeah.
If anyone disruptive, I'll just kick them out straight away. So.
Well, they always come in eventually, don't they?
Kind of like.
You had any more problems, or is it all going smooth in that regards?
Yeah, I don't get involved anymore. I just avoid them, you know. I don't get involved, but I just did. Man, you know, I just let him come on and say his stuff about some of these things people have been saying about him, you know. So I just keep out of it.
They've been saying more stuff.
Yeah. I just try.
What's the story in Ballymore now?
If you start at the beginning, G-Man gives his take on one or two things, you know, so.
Oh, I've been a bit out of touch, to be honest. I've been, I've been away from it. But
I just try and keep out of it, but I just wanted to give a bit of support to G-Man today.
Oh yeah. I like G-Man's friend. I don't know if you've have you had the pleasure of speaking to, is it Ken Jones or Mr. Ken Jones?
No, I haven't, mate.
Oh, no. G-Man's got a friend who sometimes speaks on his channel. He's got his own channel. I think his channel is called Mr. Ken Jones. I'm not sure, but I think that's his name. But he's a really good spirit-filled man by his videos. good sound doctrine, you know? Good stuff.
Oh, no, I've not seen that.
Oh, bless you.
Sorry about this, Richard.
No, you're okay. What cough it out. Out with the bad, in with the good.
So what have you been studying? Anything good?
Well, scripturally wise.
Yeah.
Oh, I've just been, you know, reading my Bible as usual, not too deep in study, just kind of keeping my correction, you know, keeping the whip to the back, as it were. Mm. Keeping myself, you know, when you, because you're hanging around with people on the internet who have different doctrines on hell and on salvation and on redemption, from when the return of Christ and these sorts of things, and if you're not careful, it can pollute or dilute or obscure your your understanding. So you've got to keep your eyes on the word while I'm trying to, because you know, when you're talking to these people, you've got to keep yourself in the word of God, which is the truth, you know. So you can take your doctrine from there. But I've been reading a lot about the return of God, really.
Sorry, Rich.
Sorry, mate. You're saying?
No, I was just trying to find the video on Google Hangout, on YouTube, just to see what was happening. If any comments were being made, just went on while you were talking. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'll be reading this book by is it J.E. Darby? I might have that wrong. I might have his initials wrong.
J.N. Darby.
Yeah, Darby. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. He's a brethren guy.
Yeah, he's a brethren, but I like his book. The book's on the return, and it's scripturally based.
Yeah.
It's a good book, actually. I'm enjoying it so far.
Have you got his Bible translation?
No, I haven't. No, have you?
I used to have it. I used to live down south, and I knew quite a few brethren people, and they gave me a big box full of J.N. Darby books, Stoney, Taylor, all the great Macintosh, all the great Darbyite brethren books, you know. And there's all J.N. Darby's massive library. It's like massive. He wrote such. Yeah, amazing character. Absolutely amazing. That what he did with his life for God was amazing.
Well, it shows the Lord moves on people, doesn't it?
Yeah. And his Bible translation is one of the best translations ever as well, if you ever get a chance to get hold of it. But I had a copy, but I gave it away.
It's typical, isn't it? I think we always end up giving our best stuff away.
I know. And it is. It's one of the best.
Yeah. No, I've still got just a regular King James, and I've got an old. I've got a load of old King Jameses, you know, some of the from the 19th century translations.
Yeah.
Or recopies, or whatever you want to call it, reprints. The great big ones.
If you get a chance, Rich, if you get a chance, mate, get hold of. I'm just getting it here now. I think you'd really like it. If you get hold of the Henry Morris Study Bible, King James Version, and it's about, it's only about 10 quid. It's a massive book. And at the back of it, it's got tons of notes on creation and evolution, you know. So, someone like you would really get a lot out of it, because it's just too much.
Yeah.
I mean, you know. So it's called the Henry Morris Study Bible, King James Version, about 10 to 12 quid, and it's really good.
Oh, Henry Morrison.
Yeah, you can get it if you type in Metropolitan Tabernacle Bookshop. Spurgeon was...
Metropolitan?
Yeah, Tabernacle Bookshop.
Book shop,
and you go on their website there, and you can find King James versions pretty cheap and stuff like that. But you can get a good study Bible of Henry Morris, which at the back of it has got loads of notes on creationism and everything.
Ah,
he was the one who started the Renaissance. I think it was in the 70s where he wrote a book on the flood. You probably see it. And, you know, he was the one that started that renaissance of going back to scripture and looking at science from a scriptural point of view, you know. So.
Have you got a Thompson's Bible then? Do you use a Thompson's?
I haven't got one. I used to have one. I haven't got
Yeah, I've got. Because they're quite good as well. I've got one.
Yeah, they're okay. I used to have one, but I haven't got it. I keep giving all my study Bibles away. I had quite a few. No, and I ended up giving. I've ended up giving them away, so I need to get a couple of more because it's good to have more than one.
Well, are you like me, Jason? When you walk around like the flea markets, you see a nice Bible, you pick it up and buy it, but then you kind of feel like, should I have bought this? Because someone else might have brought it. You know, that kind of feeling like you might have stopped someone else from reading it, sort of thing.
Yeah. I feel guilty though. Yeah. I'm always buying. There was in the bookshop in Manchester last week. There's a Christian bookshop, and then at the back they've got secondhand stuff. And yeah. There was like four really academic books: IVP Dictionary of Paul's Theology, IVP's Dictionary of the New Testament. Sorry.
Like, yeah.
Just got a cup of tea here. And there was these four academic works, and they were like £5 each, and normally they'd be like 25, 30 quid each. And I'm like debating, should I get them, not. In the end, I didn't get them, but normally I would have got them. When I get them, I give them away.
Well, that's probably the thing to do, isn't it?
Just having a blue ribbon.
Yeah, that's it. No, I know the feeling. I regularly pick up a good book, and then I think maybe I should have not brought that. But then at the same time, I buy a lot of atheist books just to burn.
Yeah.
You know, it's a cheap firelighter. You know, it stops someone else from being brainwashed by the nonsense. You know. I'll come out and say it. I don't care.
Well, I know this. I've not read one atheist book yet. And I mean this. I've not read one atheist book yet that's worth reading.
Me too. I mean, the arguments are so bland and poor. Wow. I mean, Richard Dawkins, basically, in his books, he concedes there could be a God. That's as far as he goes. There could be. And then he goes out a step further to say that they're probably, you know, other than blatantly say it, he does imply that there's good evidence for it. But then he goes on his own tangent of imagination and, you know, storytelling to explain how there mustn't be. You know, really, really bad fiction. bad fiction novel.
I read his book a while back, The Blind Watchmaker, and I was reading it.
Yeah, I got that one.
Because he's got some kind of expertise in... I don't know where he got the information from, but a lot of it was the way bats...
echolocation, yes.
Yeah, and a lot of it's all about bats and stuff. And I'm thinking, well, okay, so you know a lot about bats, but that doesn't prove your point. You know, it's not... talk about bats does not mean you can jump from that to say that God didn't create the world or there's no design in the world. You know what I mean? It's just crazy.
Yeah. He does the same thing in The Selfish Gene and in, the other ones, anyway. One of the other ones, he does the same thing where he basically speaks about something which has nothing to do with the topic, then says, well, there you go, you know, kind of anyway. Really bad. I mean, this is why the academics kind of say, well, Richard Dawkins isn't an academic, and it's because it doesn't take a scientist, you know, it doesn't take a rocket scientist anyway to distinguish that fact. kind of sad, really, because so many atheists are really, really taken by the man. They really like his rhetoric, you know, and I think he's more of an entertainment figure, if I'm not correct.
Well, I think you're correct, because when he talks about his mathematical model for evolution in what's the book, the Greatest Show on Earth, in there, he talks about he's on about his mathematical model that he does in the computer. I mean,
that's right.
The point is, he put in order to get his models, he puts the variables in the computation.
Yeah.
So it's already doctored before it even begins, which is a contradiction, because at the end of the day, You know what I'm getting at?
Yeah, absolutely.
Crazy.
I think it's hilarious.
It's hilarious.
Absolutely crazy. I mean, you put your computational input, you put it all together, and you say, well, here's all my algorithms which don't allow it to go too obscure, and just to make sure it stays within these boundaries. And here you go. I've proven that random mutation can create the sentence, me think it's a weasel. Well, it's setting goal output. You know, I mean, anyone who knows the basic foundations of computer science will tell you which that takes intelligent input. It didn't work itself out by random mutation. It's absolutely hilarious, really.
Well, I can't understand why the atheists don't get it. It's not funny. I just don't understand it.
Well, it's a case of head in the sand, like an ostrich, isn't it? You know, you see where the evidence is going, and quickly bury your head. You know, I think, you know, because, you know, my children, you know, they're a bit young yet, but they'll look at stuff and they'll see some of the comments made on television and they'll say, that's not right, you know, that doesn't make sense. And I you know, they can make it out for themselves. I mean, they're not academics, they've got no PhDs and all this stuff, or years in study or years in biology. They can see that a man and a woman produce a child. They can see that a monkey and a monkey produce a monkey, you know. Yeah. There's no brains behind anything these people say, and it's the same storytelling they've always told. Unfortunately, in England, we've had so many years of allowing people like David Attenborough and Richard Dawkins preach their religion on television, despite the fact that Ofsted is supposed to be against the recruitment of religions on television.
Yeah.
Because we've allowed it without complaining, we've allowed people, basically the population, to be brainwashed into this hell doctrine. I mean, it's absolutely hell doctrine.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
Yeah. And the thing about the atheists that I find interesting, when you look at atheists and the books that they write, I've never seen anything where they really get Christianity, where they critique Christianity in a fair way. So, for example, if you read Bertrand Russell's book, Why I'm Not a Christian, and his critique of Christianity in there, it's not a critique of Christianity, it's a critique of Catholicism, which isn't Christianity, which isn't the biblical Christianity. And so it's a straw man. He's attacking things that those are the people who believe in Christ and as their savior are not following.
Exactly. It's the same thing Dawkins would do when he says, well, Mary can't have had, you know, she can't have been a virgin, you know, that sort of thing. As if Christians don't realize that we're talking about miraculous events.
Yeah.
You know, as if we're stupid as to think, you know, well, God's spoken and the worlds were created. You know, as if we haven't realized that we're talking about a miracle, you know, a God of miracles. Jesus rose from the dead. As if we don't realize that's a miraculous event. As if we're talking about a scientific event. You know, the very fact they don't grasp these very, very, very extremely basic concepts, it's kind of bewildering, really, isn't it? I mean, I don't know what to say. I don't really know what to say to people who preach that sort of thing, because obviously they've taken their extreme anti-beliefs to, you know, to that degree.
And I don't know how you've got a reply to this, but I always ask them, and I've never got an answer that has been intellectually fair and honest. And the question that I've asked them is, all right, if you don't believe in miracles and you claim you're intellectually honest and you claim that you're open-minded, could you give me a criteria that you have that you can use or that you use to assess whether miracles have taken place or not? And I've never ever yet met one atheist who's said, I have a criteria. And what that tells me is they're not rejecting miracles based on that they've looked at the evidence. They're rejecting miracles based on a presupposition. They've already decided, before they even look at the evidence, that there is no God, that there is no supernatural. And they've closed themselves off before they even begin to look at any evidence. And I've never seen any atheist that said to me, well, if a miracle's taken to happened in history, then I have a criteria, and here's my criteria, and I've used it, and according to my criteria, it doesn't stand up. And then when they said they haven't got a criteria, I said, well, actually, David Hume, he had a criteria. He had five criteria, and he applied it to a certain period of history, the Jainist in, I think it's the 1600s, who were seeing miracles and reporting miracles, and he used his five criteria, and he said, according to my five criteria, these miracles took place. And then David Hume said after that, even though they agree with my five criteria, I still believe, ultimately, that miracles don't exist because we don't see miracles today.
Exactly. That's brilliant. I think we should be, as Christians, really pushing that. That they don't, they refuse to express what their criteria is for falsifiability. You know, what would falsify this claim? And even when we come close to that, to measuring that up, they never want to either face the implications of what those implications might be from a theological standpoint, or a scientific standpoint, or mathematical, you know, kind of what the probability of that happening standpoint. They always want to, it's always, I seem, this, you might disagree, but I think it's always an emotional response you get from atheists, where they say, well, you know, they'll say, well, that's bull crap, because they've already, like you say, they've already predetermined that they don't believe that. Rather than actually being really analytical and scientific about it. I mean, what brought me to Christ is I wanted to know if God exists. I wanted to know if you know, what people have been telling me all this time, if it was true. You know, that really mattered to me. I wanted truth. But it seems today that perhaps people don't really care for truth like they used to. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've got to read some of these old books, and you see how people really regard it. I mean, there used to be a science of truth, you know, which nowadays is called theology. But, you know, people used to really give this a high, high value, seeking truth. Yes. Why? Where's that gone? Where's that value gone?
That's a good question. You know, what you're talking about, They're basically, they won't give you an answer as to what they would take for evidence for a miracle. And the thing that cracks me up is, and it happens with all these atheists, you know, you ask them about the origin of life, or the origin of the first, you know, or origin of a protein by chance, and the odds are just insurmountable. I mean, they're just ridiculous odds, yet they can just sort of hand wave it. And they'll say, well, you know, it happened somehow. And in a way, that's like hand-waving a naturalistic miracle. I mean, because it had to have been a naturalistic miracle. Incredible chance-defying, odds-defying event that, assuming it did happen. But they just they think nothing of those unbelievable, invincible odds. And they just say, well, the point is, though, that they put faith in that without even knowing it or without even thinking about it. And it's the same thing with a lot of, you know, the beginning of the universe, you know, the beginning of life, the first cell, the first everything, basically, the origin of pretty much everything is a colossal, you know, chance event. You know, the odds of that happening by chance are, that's what the fine-tuning argument's all about. So they're able in their minds to rationalize it. So it's kind of laughable.
Do you think we should be pushing that?
What's that?
Tommy.
What's that?
Do you think we should be pushing more that they produce their own, you know, what they think would, how did you say it now, just now, Jason? They should, their own method for how they would falsify it, how they would prove it not true, or how they would prove it this is a miracle, how they would go about it. They should at least explain, you know, offhand. You know, because otherwise they're entering into a conversation where they've got no grounds for debate at all. I mean, it's like talking to, you know, it's like a debate on quantum physics with two comedians. You know, they've got no grounds on, you know, supposedly no grounds to have the debate at all. Do you think we should be pushing that, or?
I definitely think so. But the thing is about the 80s, most of them, not all of them, they're crafty. They're like snakes. It's very hard for them. They don't want to show their hand. They just want to try and knock down, don't they? But it definitely should do that, yeah.
Yeah.
The other thing as well I found with the 80s is that they only see a certain type of knowledge as significant and only one type of knowledge. So, for example, anything that they deem scientific, whatever it is, then that's important. And when you start talking about the Gospels and history and how we verify things in history, most of them can't get their heads around that because for them that's not important kind of knowledge. So you're limited in the conversation that you can have with them because they come with a straitjacket that you can only look at something from one particular way of knowing. And I found that quite extensive amongst the
Yes, because they don't want to believe. They just don't want to. Which I never got that. You know, even when I was a lost person, I didn't understand. I wouldn't have understood. You know, I kind of always believed in God, sort of in my heart, that it was true, that He was true. But I wasn't saved, and it was more of an intellectual acknowledgement. But I can't wrap my mind around these people who are God haters. I don't get that at all, and just don't want to believe, are not looking for the truth. So, yeah, they do wear kind of an intellectual, mental, emotional straitjacket that it kind of disallows any information or evidence or facts that contradicts what they want to believe.
Yeah, and
I would say this, though. Sorry, Jace.
Just quick, and then the other thing as well, I've seen it, especially with you, Richard, that... You know, Richard, both of you can handle yourself talking about evolution, definitely both of you. What I've seen with you, Richard, I've seen it with Tommy as well, where they're just not really engaging with the argument. All they do is just attack you as a person. And they never, it's very rarely you'll actually get them debating on a topic for a long period of time where you can actually just keep to the topic. Most of the time I've seen them just attacking you as individuals, and that shows the emptiness of their culture. That they just haven't got any. I mean, if you look at Matt Slick is a really good debater. He's well known, and he'll debate any atheist. He's been on Bible Thumping Week, not show. He's debated Aaron Lyre. He's debated King Crocoduck. He's debated Deconverted Man. So he'll debate famous atheists, not famous atheists, and gives opportunity for people to really engage with him. But from our perspective, they won't, Aaron Rahr or people like that, they won't engage with like Tommy or you. You know what I mean? And instead, they just allow a few silly people who are childish attack you and do silly things against you. But they won't engage in decent dialogue and discussion. And I think if they did, they know that they wouldn't be able to substantiate what they claim.
Well, a lot of these guys, they don't like debating the little guys because they really have nothing. They're on the wrong side of the truth. I think they know that instinctively. So they can't really win. It's because if the little guy shows them up, that's really bad. You know, and that would forever discredit any whatever sort of, credibility that they had. So that's why even the big creationists or the big evolutionists like Dawkins, a lot of those guys won't debate Christians, creationists who are knowledgeable in the public square. They don't. They'll debate God. They'll debate atheism or theism, but they won't debate evolution. Not always, but a lot of them won't.
Yeah, also, us three here speaking now, I can't say confidentially because we're live, but we've all spoken with the same atheist. We've all had the same debates with the same, and I will say it, few people. And we've all been in the circles with the same few people. And these same few people have treated us the same way and have the same mentality that what we're saying is wrong no matter what, and they refuse to engage in a really academic, truthful debate, but instead it's always an emotional, you know, bring you down as a person, attack you as an individual, as your personality, as your human flaws, rather than attack you on what you're saying truth-wise. You know, is it true what you're saying? Can we prove it or disprove it? And those same few people seem to really be time wasters. And you look at what what Paul says, I think it was me and you, Jason, had a conversation once before about what Paul says in, I think it's 1 Corinthians, we talk about, you know, a thorn in my flesh sent from Satan to buffet me, lest I become, you know, exalted, you know, and all that. It seems as if these people are real time wasters that are sort of in our way, almost purposefully, to stop us from preaching the word. That's not to say that God's put us there to put us off, but actually they kind of sharpen our sword in that we know what to look for is what's going to waste our time and who's worth actually preaching to. And when I say worth preaching to, it's not on our kind of, you know, it's not on our heads to make that distinction, but really, you know, are these people actually going to listen, or is this more of an emotional debate? I mean, you've got to look at the comments on your videos to see if this person is really worth engaging with. You know, when you see someone come along saying, oh, everything you said was absolute rubbish, you know, or, you know, that's to say it in clean words. But when that kind of person says that, what they're really saying is, I don't care what you say, I'm not going to listen. Now, if you reinterpret it that way, you can see exactly who you're speaking with. And it's not worth your time engaging with that person. If you get someone who asks you an honest question like, what does it mean to be saved? Or what are the implications of this, that, the other? You know, what does this mean? Or what does that mean? When did you get saved? Can you share your testimony with me? Those sort of questions, of course, those are the sort of people you want to engage with, because they're people who are asking honest questions. And again, we're asked to always be ready to give a reason for why we believe. And I think that's a good example, isn't it?
I totally agree. Totally agree with you. Yeah. Guys, do you want to just, before, in about 10 minutes, I'm going to be off. Will you guys just give a shout out to your channels, what your channels are about? I will put a link under the video at some stage, maybe tomorrow or on Monday, but just so people know who you are if you want to check you out.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of hard to find on YouTube, because if you type in Tommy Hall, it doesn't come up. So I don't even know how to tell people how to get there, but yeah, maybe I can give somebody a link. But my channel, there's not that much activity on it, and I don't have many followers, so it's you know, it's there, but that's about what I can say. But I've got several things on it. I have varied interests, so like I play the guitar, so I've got a couple little guitar ditties on there. I'm a dad of three girls, and so I'm, you know, we've kind of played with puppets for their whole lives, and so I've kind of taken that talent and their little sock puppets. So there's four or five little skits on there that kind of poke fun at evolutionists and atheists. So those are very, I think, highly entertaining. And there's the other. The other thing that I do is I write my own music and songs and sing and play the guitar and sort of hunt and peck on the piano and try to make all that into a coherent song. And so I do end up recording them. And so there are four or five of those songs on there. So, and then there's a couple, there's several videos that I've made to, various evolutionist challenges and various evolution videos. So between those three or four things, there's not that many videos. There's probably only maybe 20. So I'm not an avid video maker. So that's about what you could probably find.
Yeah, thanks.
And weirdly, my channel is quite similar. It's a bit of sporadic. Sorry, excuse me. Sporadic here and there kind of videos, mixture of my own weird kind of music. I call it music and not guitar playing because Tommy's very good at the guitar. but I do some animations and cartoons and stuff. Lately, as you can see from my avatar, I've been doing some with the Prophet Muhammad. The following, I think we should emphasize. And how recently, I would just say this quickly while it's on the top of my head, I think we should be appealing to make the Quran illegal, because it's incitement to cause violence, to do violence, and to cause damage to other people, if not death. I think it should be made an illegal document, simply because it's hate preaching, no different from what Hitler was preaching, you know. So anyway, yeah, my videos are just kind of rubbish anyway, but I'd advise people click on Jason and go to Tommy's channel. I like Tommy's puppet channel. the puppet's very good, actually. Alma?
Ima. Yeah, her name is Ima. I'm an ape.
Oh,
yeah.
Sorry. Oh, I'm an ape.
Yeah, I'm an ape. She's an evolutionist.
I thought her name should be Lucy.
Yeah, there, yeah, it would have worked.
Yeah. All right. Anyway, that's all I got to say. Anyway, yeah, cheers talking to you guys.
Yeah.
And it's a nice evening.
Okay, guys, I'm going to give each one of you the last day if you want to just say anything you want to say just for a couple of minutes. And then we'll close in prayer. I'll just pray us out. If that's all right, guys.
Cool, yeah, pray out.
So, I mean, if you want to sum up the Google Hangout, or if you want to just say something that's on your mind or share something or whatever, just feel free.
Go ahead, Richard. I'm looking for something to say that we haven't said in the last couple hours.
Oh, sorry. I don't really know now. I've put on the spot. Whenever someone says, you know, say something, my instinct is to somehow jam up.
Well, you two are thinking, I'll say something, and then you two guys after me, and then I'll close in prayer after. So I think for me, I've really enjoyed this conversation. It's been really good. It's just nice to touch base with brothers and sisters. You know, no sisters came on today, but it was just good to talk to each other as brothers and just share the scriptures and chat. So I enjoyed that, and it was good to have a chat with G-Man, and I think, you know, being me and Tommy were honest with him, and I thought he took it well, and also he shared some really good stuff about the Christian faith in answering questions there, so that was good, and it's just been a good hangout. I've really enjoyed it. Excuse me. Over to you guys.
Golly, I still haven't really thought of much. Go ahead, Richard. I might think of something in a minute.
Passing the ball back to me. I've missed quite a lot of what was said. I clicked on earlier and I was listening to a bit, but I went away, so I've missed quite a lot of what was said. I would have liked to have spoken more with G-Man. Not that I think it's any less of a pleasure to speak with you kind gentlemen, but I had some things I'd like to say to, it's not say to, as in to talk at, but to speak with G-Man about any personal things I think I could improve on in his channel and in his preaching to the choir ministries. But I'd like to say this, and I hope you guys will agree, that I think it's just so much easier on, it just feels you know, that pain in your neck is just not there when you speak with other Christians in hangouts. Mm-hmm. You know, when you enter into a hangout where there can be just one atheist in there, and the tension of the kind of ongoing complaining, because that's what I see it as nowadays. I don't see it as they've got really a clever idea, or I mean, I've come on hangouts before and people said, "Oh, it's Richard Raspberry. I've come up with an argument to refute theism," you know, and I've heard this so many times before, and usually it comes down to a moral argument or a scientific evolutionary argument, and it's so bland and repetitive. But it's just so nice to speak with Christians in a, and I always feel this when I'm with Jason. I feel such peace in his hangouts. It's lovely to come into a Jason hangout when I get a chance.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's just so much smoother. You can speak, and it's not like you said at 1:42 that blah blah blah. You know, they keep documents on you. You know, so I'd just like to say thanks for Jason and cheers for speaking with Tommy. It'll be you, Tommy.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I enjoy your music videos, by the way. Keep them up.
Thanks. Yeah, I was gonna say that I've got another one. That if I can get it done tonight, I mean, it's just a lyric video I'm gonna make of a song that's been pre-recorded, but it's kind of a more of a gritty sort of guitar based. It's got both acoustic guitar and electric guitar in it, so it's kind of cool. I like that kind of music. But yeah, I guess I'll just echo you guys. And there's something as well. Well, okay, so yeah, just to echo what you said, Richard. I mean, the cool thing is that with Christians and Christian hangouts is you don't have to try to persuade anybody. And that's what it generally is with atheists or evolutionists. You're, even if it's just one in the room and there's like several Christians in the room, you still end up trying to persuade people. So, but it's good. It's a good thing to get in with Christians, especially in a small group, you know, when we kind of just sort of stretch out and unfold our minds and just sort of and talk and not have to worry about being interrupted, which is a big thing for me because I guess I'm not a strong personality in that way that I can just, you know, slice in a conversation and carve my way into it and interrupt people. And likewise, when some of these big talkers butt in, it's like, okay, go ahead, finish your point. Then I'll try to finish. So it is kind of cool here. And I agree with you. Jason has really good hangouts, and it is a good thing because it's kind of like you really get to spill what's in your heart and in your mind. And so I think this is awesome, and we should get more people in here like this. And just to kind of do that sort of thing, just hang out for a couple hours and just let your heart spill. So I guess that's pretty much it. I love both you guys and all my brothers and sisters out there. I pray for all you guys, and like I said earlier, we are under attack, and it's good to be around y'all, so I appreciate you, love you.
Thanks, Tommy, and thank you, Richard. It's been good to have you both on. Love you both, and it's been good. Your contributions, both of you, are always good, and been good tonight, so I'm going to pray, if that's all right, guys.
Sure.
And pause in prayer and stuff. Father, we come before you today, and Father, we just give you this Google Hangout. Lord, we just pray that everything that's been shared today by me, G-Man, Tommy, and Richard, Lord, into you, and we just pray, Lord, that you would use it for your glory. We pray people might come to know you and be born again. And Father, we pray that for those who know you, that we might walk your way, that we might follow you, that we might walk in the joy of the Lord. Because, Lord, it is about joy. It's about the joy of knowing you as our Savior, as our God. And we thank you for this joy, that joy that passeth all understanding, a joy that's deep and abiding, a joy that will get stronger and more wonderful as the years go on and as we are with you forever and ever. Father, we just thank you for this time together. I pray for my brothers tonight. I pray that you bless G-Man. Give him wisdom, Lord, who to debate. giving people that will support him, encourage him, and just bless him in all that he does. And we pray for Tommy too, that you would strengthen him, give him wisdom who he may debate, and give him the wisdom to know what videos to make, and bless his time on YouTube for your glory. Bless his family and be with his family. And we pray for Richard too, Lord. We thank you for him, and we pray for all that he does for his family, that you bless him and his family. And Father, we pray that whatever he does on YouTube or whatever he does, Father, that you would continue to guide and bless him. And Father, we pray for the power and presence of the Holy Spirit upon this work that we've done today, Lord. And we pray for our brothers and sisters on the internet, that you bless them. We pray for the atheists, Lord, that they would come to know you, know the love of Christ. Because, Lord, at the end of the day, it's not about Richard or me or G-Man or Tommy or any of us, Lord. It's about you. It's about your glory and your honor. And so, Lord, we pray that everything that we've done tonight will bring you glory and honor, and that people will be drawn not to us, but to the living Savior, Jesus Christ, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. That was beautiful, Jason.
Amen. Amen.
Beautiful.
Have a good evening. Good sleep.
Alrighty.
And catch you soon. I'll try and do another one sometime and invite you guys on, yeah.
Brilliant. Yeah, and that works out good, Jason, if you can, yeah, just send me a message on Skype. That's awesome, because we can touch base a little easier, because I'm kind of hard to catch on here anyway, because I'm in and out. So, anyways, it's good stuff. Thanks both y'all.
I'm going to wait till you guys go off, because when I go off and say you're there, somehow an atheist will pop up and they'll have the last minute of the thing. I've just got to make you guys go off.
Right.
I can close it and they can't jump on.
Okay,
well, thank you.
Catch you later.
All right. See you,
Tommy.
All right.
God bless, guys. Take care.
God bless.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.